Good afternoon, colleagues. Here is Anastasia Alexandrovich with Press Club. Thank you very much for joining our broadcast. Today we have an interesting topic on our agenda. We have a presentation of the research about the Belarusian national identity. We'll talk about how Belarusians live with each other, how national identity influences the social value and other transformations. Today we have Philip Bikanov, who is a Belarusian sociologist and the person in charge of this research. And also we have Hienadz Korshunau, the senior analyst of the Center for New Ideas, and Lesia Rudnik, who is a Belarusian political analyst. The discussion will be as follows. The first will be Philip, who will tell us and show us interesting slides. He will be followed by Hienadz and Lesia. Then we'll have a time for Q&A. So you're welcome to write either in the Zoom chat or to comment, leave your comments under the broadcast. Or you can alternatively raise your hand in the Zoom and ask a question. I think we can start, Philip. The floor is yours. Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you very much, Nastya, for having us at the Press Club platform. It's great to have you. I'm thanking colleagues for joining us today. I would like to thank our audience for finding time to listen to us. Today, I will try to very briefly tell you about some key concepts that we have touched upon in our national identity research. I must be blunt, there's a lot of information that we will not be able to cover everything. So we'll try to show you some 20% of what we have discovered. The full version of the research will be available to the registered users. It will be sent to you by the Press Club. They will also be available at the Hodna channel. Some people turn to us for access. Today I'll show you several slides and tell you in detail how it worked. I'll try to make it within 30 minutes. Then my distinguished colleagues, Hienadz and Lesia, will criticize the research or apply the research prism, research lenses. Maybe we'll have time for Q&A. Right, let's start. I'm sharing the presentation. Can you see the presentation? Can you share the screen? Great. So, the national identity of Belarusians. Today we'll have several blocks of information. I've selected the most important information that they'll try to cover today. A few words about the research. It was an online survey. We surveyed about 1,500 people. These are all urban dwellers. There are about 20,000 settlements. This sample was proportional to the settlement. We conducted this research in October 2021. We will compare it with a similar survey on a similar topic conducted in May 2020. It wasn't really in May, it was in April 2020. So a month before everything started turning in Belarus. So this comparison is quite interesting overall. I will be able to answer a more detailed question later on. What is the main prism today? It's the attitude to the national identity. We give to people a lot of statements that you can see on the screen. People could agree or not agree with them to this or that extent. And the replies were grouped into three main categories, what we call the components of the national identity. The first one is called the Belarusian one, which is a love to the Belarusian language, Belarusian culture. is the number of settlements. In the previous search, the next column was called the Russian Soviet. It was connected with a nostalgic spirit and something that is connected with the Russian narrative. And the third component, which is also very important, is called cosmopolitan. If you agree to what is said here, it means you basically say no to not only Belarusian values, but some national values. Hence, this tool allows us to divide the site into four parts related to the national identity. The name of the segments, the titles of segments, are a legacy from the previous surveys, but we have conscientious, Soviet, indifferent, and conforming. The Soviet ones does not mean that the people will go to the streets waving Soviet flags. It means that the Soviet history, Soviet past is more close to them. The conscientious are the people who value highly the Belarusian national identity. The indifferent have the very strong cosmopolitan factor, and the conforming are the most cosmopolitan, that do not feel Belarusian and do not feel the national identity. The last one, as I said, the conforming is made of the young people, is it the youngest cluster that was formed already inside the Belarusian national state that was built during the Lukashenko's time, that was projecting some autonomous national thoughts. However, it was totally separate to the national element. So the national culture for those people was important, but the democratic policies and democratic agenda was not. So we call this conforming. People who conform with the Lukashenko regime's policies. Here's the dynamics. In 2020, we saw that the largest segment consisted of people who had the Soviet narrative closest to them, marked in red. In 2021, it was went down 10%, but the number of conforming people grew by 15%. In a nutshell, what happened? There was an increase of the national spirit was connected with the events of August 2020 and what followed, because there was the biggest shock that could explain it. It led to the growth of the pride of Belarusians, the national pride. At the same time, these people were more passive in the sense that they were less active than the conscientious people. It means that the views of the people transformed and looked similar to what we called conformists in 2020. I'll explain you what it means later on. We have here a slide showing who we should call Belarusian, first and foremost. Here's the list of options. We have an increase in the number of people who live in Belarus here. Compared to 2020, the structure does not really change much. The people who reared on Belarusian culture believe it's their own. It's a very inclusive approach. It is not something depending on the blood. Doesn't mean that people were born in Belarus or whose parents are Belarusians. It is quite inclusive. So, be reared in Belarusian culture, or live in Belarus, that's enough to be considered Belarusian. At the same time, we have a difference in terms of segments. We notice a serious transformation among the people who were cosmopolitan. They said that it's not that important for them to live in Belarus. Became even more important for them. They're losing the connection with their culture. The conscientious became more inclusive. We'll talk more about this later. What is this expressed then? It is expressed in the perception of the image of Belarusian. We ask people to describe in three words who is a typical Belarusian. Here are the clouds. In 2020, the cloud was like this, and in 2021 was like that. We can see that this one was much more red, with the red being negative. Negative words. Well, the well-known things like indifference and cowardness, they became less of them in 2021, which is a sign of transformation, how Belarusians started perceiving themselves. In 2020, people were more critical towards their compatriots, to those who live with them in the country. And in 2021, this perception changed. What happened? We see a change. And values like the cowardice and indifference, they went to the background. In 2020 showed that people were not afraid to express themselves, and it's transformed into a different perception of people. We see that in 2020, and that indifference and cowardice were at the top. In 2021, it went down significantly. Particularly interesting here is the segment called conscientious. Those are the people who were most national oriented even then. It was quite an exclusive segment. Most people could separate themselves from other Belarusians much easier than representatives of these segments, these three segments. They saw people similar to them. It doesn't mean that we mean here every person, but they saw more of themselves or similar people as being very proud, and they called everyone else indifferent and coward. And we see the number of the associations within the segment went down twofold. At the same time, we see a decrease of the negative mentions. In 2021. So what are the other traits of the national identity? We see also a very interesting trend here, a growth of the self-identification. And the first time this question was asked in 2009. So we see here a trend, but I suggest we compare it 2020 with 2021, with several similar samples and approaches. We see here a growth in the following things. That we see the graph with Belarusian patriot. We'll focus on this later. We see growth here across the board, both the Soviet segment and the conscientious segment experience this growth, while the Soviet segment is more inclined to believe that the preservation of the power in the same hands of Lukashenko is proper. But many people believe that they are patriots of Belarus, and people similar to them. At the same time, the patriotism is perceived in a different way. Both groups are fighting for a dignity and pride, but they perceive it in a different way, as you probably can see from what we hear from in both opposing camps. What else happened? We see the change in the locality level in terms of identity. People call themselves more often the citizens, dwellers of the country, than they do call themselves the dwellers of a particular settlement. We asked them, who do you feel as? Do you feel as Belarusian citizens or people living on this or that rural area or city? We hear also see the higher levels of locality have more people joining this camp. This is the feeling of patriotism and the unity of Belarusians that plays an important role. We'll discuss the conflict more. So the topic of the symbols and the flags is particularly important. Rigor Stepenia described the dynamics in terms of the flag perception. And the Yellow Leaks Telegram channel was using this as well. But the picture, in fact, is less pleasant for the proponents of the red and green flag, because in 2020, it was indeed the flag of the majority of the Belarusians. No question about it. 82% called it their own, apart from the group of the nationally identity. In 2020, there was a drastic change, and we have two groups who no longer identify themselves with the red and green flag. At the same time, the white, red, white flag is not the totally attractive symbol to them, and they're now in gray zone. Why it happened like this? Because white, red, white, and green and red flags are markers of the political conflict that we are experiencing. I would say that they lost, not really lost, but they changed their meanings that they used to have before the 2020 election. The white, red, white was more about the national spirit, while the red, green was about Belarus that has been built for many years with a very success. Currently, it's about the opposing camps, and the red and green flag is very much about what was done under this flag, and the white, red, white is about the protest against Lukashenko. Does not necessarily mean a clear-cut connection with the national spirit. A few more words about the needs. Basically, how people see their lives, what has been satisfied, what hasn't. The political needs for the people are important. They feel it. The level of freedom, level of number of ways to protect their rights. Many people show that they don't feel protected, properly protected. Everything that has been satisfied is about their personal life, not about the public environment. Everything public is on this side and doesn't always depend on them. So we see the tension in the society. Talking about the identity, the topic of the Belarusian language should not be avoided. We'll touch upon this as well. What is the situation with the Belarusian language? Very few people used it in their daily life, about 96 to 97% of respondents in 2020 and 2021 were using Belarusian Russian language, the Russian language for communication. So very few people use it in their daily life. It wasn't much different to, it didn't really vary in terms of the settlements or the age. It is a certain marker for the people who are, have a very strong national identity. At the same time, we see a different picture when we ask people about the mother tongue. That's what we see here. The Belarusian language is a we also asked, made people state, we grouped the statements to two blocks. The language is an important part of the identity, and the language is a not that important part of the identity. We see that there's a serious difference between important and non-important. For the people for whom this is a very integral element of their identity come from the conscientious segment. For others, this is not particularly that important. They do not determine themselves, define themselves through this. It's important to understand here that the status of the Belarusian language in Belarus is currently is like a family vase that is on the shelf. Nobody's using it much. Not many people do, at least, but it's very pretty. But if it breaks down, everyone is sad. It is a cultural attribute rather than something that is used in the daily life. Consequently, after 12 months, we didn't see much change there in terms of Belarusian language. Here we conclude that the attitude to the language and the image of Belarusians in the eyes of self-perception and others and identity transformation, the language doesn't play the major role here. It's not a driver for such processes. A few more words about geopolitical orientation, particularly in the context of what is happening. There are several groups of countries. We measured the attitude of Belarusians to them. They also put into blocks, into segments. What we called others, we see very interesting countries. Kazakhstan was there even before things started. So Russia, China, Venezuela, the neighboring countries are basically the countries that are more locally involved in the situation in Belarus, particularly the neighbors like Lithuania, Poland, and Ukraine. And the less active Western countries, they united in the third group. The less active have a similar attitude. And this segment of conscientious doesn't like this group. At the same time, the same segment likes this group. The Soviet-minded people like it less, again, by drawing parallels with the Chatham House research. There are very few people who really dislike Russia. A few more words about Russia. We ask people about the deepening integration. This topic comes up on the agenda regularly. What we see is that there are prospects for the integration.
Скажем так, у нас нет большинства
We don't have a majority that would say that they're ready to support it. The majority is shown by one of the segments called the Soviet. But then we'll see that those who support integration, when they go deeper and ask them what is meant by this, we ask people if integration happens, what it should be about. Nobody understands what it is. People do support it. Most popular things are visa-free regime that is really working. Some scientific cooperation. None of it is over 50%, even among the people who support integration. They don't really understand what they want from this integration. We look at everything, at everyone. The picture is different. I wouldn't say that there's some concrete demand here, even though this is an important part of the identity, particularly of the conflict, our demand for integration, even among those who play active role in the conflict. It's almost not available, the tangible part. It's more of a manifestation of feelings like we are brothers with Russians, and that's it, stops there. It does not transform into anything else. And next, the slides about people being satisfied or unsatisfied about what is happening in the country. You can see here rural and urban areas. There's a group of people in this identity conflict who are more happy than everyone else. They believe that Belarus is moving in the right direction. And there's a driver of people who are the nucleus of unsatisfaction. Around them, they form other segments of the identity. Perception. Hence, what is the biggest problem for Belarusians right now? It's the economy. People do not feel protected, do not feel safe. Here are some global issues like the COVID, political instability, and the social issues. The communal services and others. We see that there is a segment for which the political stability is very important, on the background of the economic instability, and for others, the economic instability plays a major role here. It's something more tangible for them. Why did I say all this? I wanted to talk more about the social tension and the conflict existing in society. I need to speed up here, I think. We developed at some point in the past. We asked people to evaluate or assess how they whether they trust people or certain agencies. We've come up with a number of agencies that enjoy different level of trust. And we have here three groups that could be called proponents of the authorities, the loyalists, the opponents, and the people who are mistrusting the authorities. Here it's very much similar to what we saw in terms of trust in the state. This is very important. There is a serious conflict in the society. It's a value conflict. These people have various, totally different value structure. It's very important for this segment. Civil rights, political activity, spirituality, there's very much about the opponent. In terms of geopolitical differences, there are a lot of them. People feel that there is a block of countries that support them and a different block, other block that does not support them, and they clearly separate it. In terms of integration, I have a similar situation, similar picture. The proponents of the authorities, they talk more about the integration of Russia and Belarus. At the same time, they don't really understand what they want to do with integration. It's one of the signs of geopolitical conflict. We see a small graph about the interconnectedness of, and we see the backbone here made of the people who have a very strong national identity, Belarusian identity, as a foundation for their world perception. And the next segment have nostalgic views about the Soviet Union, and they agree more about with the Russian, modern Russian narrative, with the unity of three states, three nations. At the same time, both of them feel themselves as patriots. For the opponents, with the opponents, it's a different story, because they don't feel that the state is, they've been, is what they support, I mean, the authorities. At the same time, they are different in terms of values. The opponents of the state, they see themselves more often than the dwellers of Europe. As citizens of Europe, we had a political dimension, and we asked people the question how much these freedoms and liberties are observed in Belarus. There's a high percentage of people who believe that they are not observed, or rather not observed. And in terms of perception of the people who are proponents, also believe that the liberties and freedoms are not observed in the country, but they don't care. What is more important here, and the most dangerous, what is most dangerous here is that people see the opposing party, they can easily say who is a threat to them, whom they're not ready to trust. And we see the group of people that are a threat. The proponents of the authorities feel that the opposite camp is a threat to them, and vice versa. And this shows how deep this conflict is and how far it can go in the heads of the people, particularly when we talk about identity, because the political dimension is very important. At the same time, one of the segments feels the support of the authorities and believes or does not believe that the system is unjust, and the second segment doesn't. It's very much in line with what the Chatham House made public not so long ago. People were asked the question whether it is their state or not. The same way, the issues of people not being ready to accept people from the other camp. Very much correlates with what we found. Where does it all come from? The information is taken from many sources. It's an online survey. We need to remember that. So the majority of the people save the information from the internet resources, but the proponents of the regime watch much more than the state TV. So if we go deeper here, the TV channels and the other channels different level. The proponents and opponents have opposing narratives. So they don't receive information from the other side. They wouldn't be filtered through their sources of information, their media outlets. And this deepens the conflict, which in many ways this picture of national identity it's under the risk of being split. And then the conflict is going deeper. We don't see any compromise on the horizon. The contradictions are very deep. And the people can identify their opponents easily among other people, which is fraught with some identity split in the future. Meanwhile, it is not here, but in the future, it may very well happen. A few words about the conclusions. The stereotype of indifferences. In the past, the people felt that their pride. They felt that they have the right to express themselves, and it led to the growth of the patriotism. Some people said that we express ourselves and we are more proud ourselves, and led to the local parameters changing that we touched upon today. And we have an escalation of differences that is exacerbated by the splits. And this is the weakest spot now. And if something happens, something bad happens, the split would be the most significant event there. Well, that's it from me. I would like to say that two presentations, the 30 pages text and 154 slides presentation, they will be distributed by the press club, and they will be later available on the website. Thank you for your attention, and back to you, Nastya. Thank you, Philip. I think now it's Lesia or Hienadz who will give the feedback. Right, Hienadz, please. Thank you. I understand we don't have too much time, so indeed what we have seen now is a small part of what is available in the report, the final report. So I suggest that everyone, after the report is available, should consult it. There will be a lot of information that will be beneficial for understanding of the process happening in the society and the point of view of new strategies. I will focus more, as you've seen, there are two main structural elements. First is the national identity. And the second one is connected with the society understanding of what is happening, the attitude to the process, to the state, and so on. I'll focus the first part. I understand that Lesia will concentrate on the political part. Well, maybe so, maybe not. Anyway, I wanted to say the following first. Usually when we talk about the national identity, the national spirit. We perceive it in the most traditional, modern sense. It is something that started in the 19th century. It's the single country, single state, single people. But it wasn't like that in Belarus. And basically, we can say that in 20th century, the classic modernist approach was not applicable to the formation of the Belarusian nation. We can talk about the wars here and so on, but the substrate, the foundation of the Belarusian nation was very different from different points of view. In the first coat of arms of Belarus, of BSSR, there were four languages, and it is part of the mentality, part of the Belarusians. The local part that Philip mentioned, it became really important. It wasn't like that in the past. It was always a neighboring mentality, the locals approach, like there's me, my family, and my neighbors. We had different neighbors, but with all of them we had very friendly relations, because some of them could be Catholic, there were Jews, Tatars, and so on and so forth. There was no single narrative. The modernist projects, they required new narratives. It was forming under the colonial influence of Russia. What we have now, we have a switch to the postmodernist society. And it is this infrastructure, this world structure, is very integral part of the Belarusian society. Here lies the problem. The problem is that we don't know what to do about it. Nobody knows, because the Western society have been breaching this evolutionary. We came there revolutionary. So the question arises, why the identity issue? Because we have been working with this phenomena using the modernist approaches, the single culture, single language, single nation, and so on. We need to have a different approach. What Philip said in terms of the language being a vase, it would be one of the pillars, because there will not be a single thing. There will be something various, but it is all important at the same time. And here again, when we talk about the political side as well, various pictures of Belarus, various models exist. But the problem is that both the so-called conscientious segment and the Soviet segments are the modernist, very modern one. And here lies the difference, the main difference between them. And the main choice will be made by those who are conformist, and unfortunately who are represent the fourth groups and who are indifferent. Well, maybe the indifferent ones will follow those who will be imposing their game. What is important for me, and what I wanted to thank the optimizers for, is because they came up with this segmentation. We see the image of the general image of Belarus being formed. Several days ago, it was Igor Babko who came up with a new interpretation, the local ones, not in the sense of Yanka Kupala, but it's very much about territory. We see a split now between those who live in this, in Belarus and abroad, who have left the country. But it's important to understand that Belarusians and Belarus is not only about Belarus, the territory where we live. Although many people focused on this, on that, in their research, Belarus is where Belarusians are, and the main question is how to create Belarus being between the poles, even though the modernist approach is going away. There will not be the rough narrative of the modernist nature. There'll be, we should have a joint approach. Thank you very much. Thank you, Hienadz. Next is Lesia Rudnik, who's a political analyst. Thank you very much. First and foremost, I would like to thank Philip for this deep, comprehensive research. It was very interesting in many ways. It had an interesting methodology. I recommend that everyone understands how this multifaceted methodology can be used. Also, I recommended this research because it draws parallel with the popular researches of Chatham House. It's interesting to see how the main conclusions, main aspects addressed by this research and that of Chatham House, they mostly coincide, they overlap, particularly when we talk about the conflicts in society. I also believe that this very research successfully divides people into three segments: the Belarusians, Russian, Soviet, and cosmopolitan. I think it's a success. But overall, if we talk about the what Gennady said, particularly what the conflict between those living inside Belarus and those who have left Belarus, I think it must be considered by the current politicians, democratic forces, and we must understand that people who left Belarus do not feel Belarusians. They do want to go back. They call themselves Belarusians, even though they may not speak the Belarusian language in their daily life. But this perception of people who have left is very much different if we analyze it through the eyes of people who are still living in the country. And the research reflects it. It's important to think not only how to settle the conflict, the national political conflict, but how the politicians should deal with it. But also we need to understand how the political discussion is developing. In the recent weeks, we've seen a lot of discussion of this sort that are very much about whether people have left or stayed in the country. Do they have a right for this or that? I think it's one of the most serious consequences that the Belarusian society will have to deal with when we switch to the next stage, the democratization. We will have the long-term effect that we have to deal with. Also, I wanted to say that in the Philips research, there is a statement that in 2021, we see this increased number of statements about the observed liberties and rights, and the people in Belarus, living in Belarus, have more attention and pay more attention to the civil liberties. And it's easy to explain after the political crisis, but after the Chatham House research publication, we see that the number of their political or neutral Belarusians has grown. It's important to understand that even though we see that the population on the one hand is becoming more apolitical and more indifferent to the political situation, there remains a significant amount of attention paid to the liberties and rights that should be provided by this state. So despite the some negative trends and detected by the research, we must pay attention to the deep aspects that show that even though Belarusians may be more afraid about talking about politics, and they still have the feeling of the national identity. Of course, they vary across the different segments that were proposed by Philip, and I really like the conclusion. I think it could have been formulated in a different way. It could be supported by some other data, but the conclusion is that the people, I'm not quoting it, but close, people who believe in astrology believe much more often that the state shouldn't observe the laws all the time. And the Philip has a part of his research saying that the people who believe in something spiritual means that these people would rely on someone, on some entity, and the state is something, is above them, an entity that makes decisions for the people. People who believe in astrology do not always think that the state should observe the laws all the time, and it makes me think that if there is a correlation in the future between the people who practice religion or and the trust in the state, and the laws being observed, where's this connection? So my main question: why did you choose astrology? So it'd be interesting for me to read about the people who practice religion. Another important conclusion is that the Belarusian identity is, on the one hand, is moving away from the Russian-Soviet narrative. On the other hand, what has been mentioned by Gennady and Philip, it changes the locality level. People feel themselves Belarusians more, while in the past it was more of a local identity. Today is the identity, the level of the country, feel themselves Belarusians and connect this feeling with the feeling of their country. The language and the culture are not the drivers of the social transformation. What unites people is, first and foremost, not the language and the culture. And I think that this is very important. Maybe this has been mentioned and everyone understands it, but this research highlighted once again that maybe the language and culture is not something we should rely on. I mean, the political forces rely on that much. Maybe should focus on some other values that unite people. Unfortunately, we see that not unfortunately, but luckily, 32% believe the Belarusian language is their native language, but their mother tongue, but only 3% use it in their daily life. However, in the conditions where the Belarusian language is not promoted at the state level, I don't feel it's a very negative trend. I think that the number of people that think that it means that if there's the proper state policy after one or two generations, the situation will change and the language may as well be enjoyed and spoken by more people in the streets. And so I suggest that we shouldn't get upset too much about this, because the state is not that bad. If we saw that 3% believe the Russian language to be the native language and 3% would use it their daily life, that would be much worse, much more sad. A few more words from me. In the research, we see that Belarusians highlight four major problems. It's something that we saw the confirmation for. The economic issues, the global challenges, the so-called pandemic, the political and social issues. At the same time, it's important, it's interesting, many Belarusians want to have good attitude from the side of the state. They want these issues to be solved by the state, but personally they're not inclined to condemn corruption or something like that. That's one of the examples. But we saw figures that over 40% believe in that it's okay to pass exam using a bribe. In some ways, citizens understand that the state owes to them something, that the state is doing something wrong, but at the same time, the people do not feel being totally responsible in this respect. Let's go back again to the parallels found in the Chatham House. I highlight once again that it's important that different research highlight the same trends, like polarization in society. We see it in both researches, that the proponents and opponents of the authorities are the worst enemies of each other. They dislike each other very much. And it's important because polarization of the society is one of the consequences that we need to, we'll have to deal with for a long time. The next parallel is that Belarusian wants to have a neutral country or to be in a union with Russia or together with the European Union. I'm always surprised by this response because it shows that Belarusians don't really understand how the international unions work, that it's impossible to be at the same time with this or that side, but Belarusians keep choosing this option. While in Chatham House, there wasn't such a question. I like this research because there's a statement that proposes to respondents to select one of them. It's interesting here that even among the proponents of the regime, 50% of the people, 50-something percent, they are in favor of the union with Russia, while 38%, as many as 38% are in favor of the collaboration with the European Union. Among the opponents of the authorities, we see the majority of them supporting the European Union, and the proponents of the authorities support the European Union as well. And the last point about media consumption. Not so long ago, there was a popular research, popular survey, several months ago, about how the protesting audience consumes information. And if we compare them in the global context, we'll see that the traditional media in Belarus are in a crisis, and they will remain there even when the political regime changes. A lot needs to be done to restore the traditional journalists, because not people do not perceive traditional newspapers, television as the genuine source of news. We may think that the internet that covers whole world, that it's becoming the main source of news. But if we look at the statistics of more or less developed countries, we'll see that radio, TV, and newspapers, they have a big share and became the main source of news consumption. The problem here is not much in polarization, in that the proponents of the authorities, they watch TV, and the opponents, they get news from the online sources, it's important to not forget that this media polarization highlights the problems of the media field and journalists. The journalists will have to deal with that in the future. Hopefully, I did not take too much of your time. I recommend once again everyone to read the full version of this research. It will be beneficial for journalists and for people who want to understand what is happening in the country. So thanks, Philip and Preskaba. Thank you, Alicia. Thank you, colleagues. I know that Philip wants to say something about astrology. In a nutshell, it wasn't our goal to highlight astrology. We had a tool that was supposed to assess the inclination of people to follow a Kaikal word formation. And we found the significant statistical connection between the astrology and the views of the people. I wouldn't call the correlation weak. I would say the magnitude is quite strong. The difference of 20% explain the trust and this high power that would deliver justice for everyone. It was a byproduct for in our research. Thank you. Thank you, Philip. But we have the Q&A session now. I know that Alexander Knarovich has questions. Andrus Medvedev also asked some questions during the registration. First, I will give floor to Alexander. Can you hear me? Yes. I would like to thank you for this presentation, for the possibility to listen to you and to see you. I'm here today by accident, but still, it's very interesting. I don't know if it will be a criticism, but what I liked today, maybe it was research before, it's still planned, but I believe that when we talk about national identity, if we don't measure it with the category of today, future with some months, but we're trying to go deeper and further. So when we talk about some history and culture, a language as the single element is not enough. Not so long ago, I had a conversation with another sociologist about this, and he said, according to one of the research, Belarusians cannot reproduce and cannot remember 10 historical figures from Belarusian history. I liked your segmentation into four groups, but it's interesting for me to understand how they all perceive this cultural historical identity. What are the perception? This is what I lacked in this research. I would really like to learn more about this. Secondly, if we don't want to solve the political task in the near future, and I know that other people deal with that, if we talk about long-term task, I think we're dealing with the following. I'll refer to the research of the sociologists that were conducted a long time ago. The sociologists said that Belarusians perceive themselves as people living on a certain territory. And for me, it meant that the Belarusian who went to France, Poland, and Lithuania assimilates very quickly with the people living in those countries. We don't have a connection. We don't have a cultural identity. We have a country identity. And I thought that this is something that is man-made. it's to be tackled over a long period of time. It will be important to understand how it works today and how people who have left Belarus perceive their identity. Thirdly, yesterday was my blog premiere on YouTube. I spoke about some economic issues, but I'll be also happy if some of the people working on this research would spend several hours talking with me there on camera about the national identity in my blog. I'll be very grateful for this collaboration and for the opportunity to use the results of your research. And the cherry in the pie, the connection between the astrology and the state, that was spectacular. Thank you. Thank you, Alexander. Right, indeed, I'll be happy to talk with you in your blog. Again, let's go back to the astrology. It's not much about religion, it's about astrology. Those are different things. So I think we shouldn't really be too serious about this. I don't want this to become the major topic here, topic for discussion. How do these three groups see themselves? In fact, it's a difficult question that was responded in the research of 2020 rather than that of 2021. But I can rely on 2020 here because there's a sturdy classification. The same groups were singled out by the same method, but the proportion changed, which means that the conclusion made in 2020 could be applied in, to the situation in 2021. There were some questions about festivals important for people, for about historical figures. In many ways, the image of Belarusian, of a Belarusian who is as a strong heritage of this Soviet narrative, it's foundational for every segment except for this conscientious one. Why so? Because we had people who are the ideal Belarusians, so to speak. The people who represent the Belarusian narrative before the Soviet Union, they are much more popular among the conscientious segment. People who have the connection with the Belarusian spirit through centuries, like Kostyuszko-Kalinowski or the historical figures, Vasily Bykov, even though Vasily Bykov is a person who lived in during the Soviet times. He's not that much about the Soviet Union, he's much more about the national identity for many people. Those are Vitov, then other Tadeusz Kostyuszko. And for others, it's more often about Jakub Kolos, Jakub Jan Kupala, the national writers of Belarus. Francis Skorina is a consensual figure here, but I cannot say that he was excluded from the Soviet or post-Soviet narrative. So something along these lines. The victory in the Great Patriotic War is in the top 10 events that unite Belarusians. Declaration of independence is more important for the conscientious and for conformists. So there are two traditions. One of them is looking for its roots in the pre-Soviet, and another is more concentrated on the post-Soviet past, and they are competing. But sometimes they come together and touch, have a points of contact. If you allow me, I just wanted to react to what has been said. The situation is very well described by the post-colonial thinking, when there's no narrative or separate narrative, the game is played along the rules that left after the empire is gone. So it's a foreign field, not own field. So another highlight of the 2020 is that this is the point that could be the starting point for our own history, and the history of the past will fit into it. But in 2020, the new history of Belarus started. I'm sorry for interfering. I cannot hold myself. Gennady mentioned a very important thing. During one of the interviews, I was asked a question. I agree that the very much is connected for Belarusians with the Great Patriotic War, as if we appeared in July 1943, but the events of the 2020 became so important that maybe they compete, they affect the situation, but there hasn't been much research about how to describe it, because the events of 2020 are not over yet, and there's still a war for the right to name things and events. So who's a traitor? This concept is used on both sides. Who are the punishers? Or who's the so-called fascist here? The narrative of the Great Patriotic War is still used, but it's modern interpretation. What will happen in the... Nobody knows, because it's not over yet. We're still, and it's probably bad, we're still living in the past. I've been saying the same thing, actually. So I'll be grateful if I'll be able to speak with Gennady about this in a different format. Thank you very much for your reply. Thank you. Yes, indeed, we can do this. Thank you, colleagues. Are there any more questions? Andrus Medvedev or somebody else? Do you want to ask a question? Should I read it? Good afternoon, friends. I wrote the question before I learned what we'll be talking about, because I understood that we had the conversations, they came mostly in Russian, and language is a very important element for me. Indeed, I will agree with what people said before me, that the identity of our people is connected with the territory. For me, it's important to identify Belarusian, because we live on this territory, this contour and the coat of arms. Today, the big number of Belarusians who have left the country, who live in Kyiv and say that they are Belarusians. They say no to integration, and I'm asking them, what do you mean by this? And they say no to integration, meaning that So the language issue is very important. A year has passed since many people left for Ukraine and they visit the courses of Ukrainian language. Many still are not very proficient in Belarusian, but many already speak very good Ukrainian and still believe that there are Belarusians. And I was felt a bit tense because the majority of today's presentation was in Russian. Based on what we saw on the slides today about the split between the different segments like the Soviet and difference and so on, I felt that we need to find a way out. We need to get together and believe the language can be the thing that could unite people, could unite around. And you probably saw what happened in 2020. It was about the symbols, white, red, white. Unfortunately, the language did not make much progress. Still, the territory of Belarus is settled not only by Belarusians, but also by other nationalities. We have Azerbaijani, Armenians, and other people living here. Andrus, I'm sorry to interfere, but what is your question? My question is, are there any ways that show that these three or four segments could be united? Did you find anything as a result of such this research? Yes, we seized such prospects. In fact, in 2020 and 2021, we saw the inclusive nature of Belarusians. The people who say that to be Belarusian, you need to have special features, traits, like be born in Belarus and have Belarusian parents and speak the Belarusian language. There are not so many of them, people who believe this. So I don't think that there's been too much split, like we have Lithuanians, Roma, and Ukrainians, and we don't have anything like this yet. I don't think it's crosses the cultural barrier. This is the perception right now. The split, as I said, is mostly political. It has some deep parts, and some of us may think that there is no way back. And I sometimes think that since I don't live in Minsk currently, not on my own will, I'm asking myself a question, how we will live with this, what we will do with this. I don't know. Something will come. Something's going to take. Something's going to give. I hope that the inclusive understanding of the national perception will remain. Just wanted to clarify that I don't think that it is bad that Belarusians identify themselves with the territory. This is one of the ways of doing this. I think we should be inclusive about this. I think it's normal. As to us speaking Russian, that's out is, you know, many Belarusians speak Russian. What to do about it? I cannot do much about myself. I cannot forget this language. I cannot make it my mother tongue. And make it my mother tongue, I don't want to. The majority of things that we researched and processed are in Belarusian language still. The majority of slides are in Belarusian. But as to the presentation, we made it in Russian. That's the status quo. Thank you very much for answering the question. I think we'll spend the rest of the day explaining why we're using this or that language. We're nearing the end of our presentation, but we do have a question from the reform.by. And it's about the cosmopolitan approach to the integration. Did anything change in 21 compared to 2020? Yes, indeed, something changed. I can show you the slide once again. We have this great slide that shows the changes compared to 2020. We have the people who felt the Belarusian environment was important, they went down. Well, we see the number of the indifferent going down and the number of the conformists going up. It has to do with the fact that positive perception of Belarusians has gone up, plus a level of self-identification with others is different now. The locality and independence perception has gone up. There are more Belarusians in the eyes of such people. Chatham House says that many people believe that they live in a bubble with the majority of their proponents, so configuration is different. We see how this configuration has changed. Thank you, Philip. Colleagues, do you have any more questions? If you do, please raise your hands. Another comment from Irina Levitska in the chat. Can you tell us more about social characteristics of the Soviet group? What could be the share of this group in the Belarusian society in general? Here we're describing the real Belarusian society. This research has been conducted among Belarusians, so more or less we can say that the urban population of Belarus is divided in the following segments. It's not only about the older generation who lived a big part of their life in the Soviet Union. It's just it's more complicated than this. You need to kind of read the full research. These are the people who don't have higher education most of the time, and more of them. Now, these are people who are different in terms of regions. I think there are a bit more of such people in the Gomel region. And if my memory serves me correct, I think it's Gomel and maybe Mogilev. Just like I said last year, the social demographic characteristics here are not the most important thing. Most important thing, values. Because the older generation, they are part of every segment that I singled out. So it's very difficult to put them all in a single group, single segment. So it's more important to understand their values. And I can see that you turned on your camera. Thank you very much. colleagues, if there are no more questions. I don't see any raised hands. I think we should call it a day. There's a great idea of Irina Olishevskaya. It was a proposal for her, from her, coming from her, about deeper discussions, more advanced discussions on this topic. I think we'll have something like that in the future. Thank you very much for being here with us today. Thank you for all the registered participants. We'll send all of you the materials from Philip. All these presentations with the slides and the reports will reach you. In the near future, on the 25th of February, there will be a presentation by the Chatham House. Please follow the newsletter of Press Club and our events. Please subscribe to our YouTube channel. So see you next time. See you soon. Thank you very much. Thank you and goodbye.